Welcome to Cardiovascular System, the heart. The cardiovascular system is a continuous, completely closed network of endothelial tubes. The general purpose of the system is to perfuse our capillary beds so that our organs are permeated with fresh blood over a narrow range of hydrostatic pressures. The heart is the main driver of the circulatory system, and it functions essentially as a pump. This tutorial will focus on the structural and functional features of the heart. I'm Dr. Catherine Moore, the histology wizard.
First, let's take a minute to look at the big picture. This diagram shows the closed nature of the circulatory system with the heart, or the pump, at the top. Arteries function to transport blood away from the heart under high pressure. Capillaries function as exchange vessels, while veins are conduits for the transport of blood from the tissues back to the heart. There are variations in blood pressures in different parts of the circulatory system, and each vessel then has specific and different functions. Thus, the structures and organization of each type of vessel are dictated by these different functional demands. We'll discuss these structures and how they allow each vessel type to function in the next video. The heart is a folded endothelial tube whose wall is thickened to act as a regulated pump, and this pump is the primary determinant of systemic blood pressure. Histologically speaking, the heart has two regions, which differ in structure, again relating to their specific functions. The heart is comprised of two atria and two ventricles. Deoxygenated blood enters the right atrium through the inferior and superior vena cava, and the right ventricle then pumps this deoxygenated blood into the pulmonary veins around the lungs. There, fresh oxygen enters the bloodstream, and the blood moves to the left side of the heart through the left atrium, and is then pumped to the rest of the body by the left ventricle. Thus, these two regions have similar but distinct functions, and that is reflected in the histology. Each region of the heart is divided into three layers. The names of the layers are the same, but there are differences between atria and ventricles, particularly in terms of layer thickness and specialized cell types. You should be prepared to know how to distinguish between these two regions and among the three layers. I'd like to take a minute to talk about terminology. Students are often confused about epithelium, endothelium, and mesothelium. Embryonically, epithelia arise from multiple germ layers, most predominantly from ectoderm and endoderm. As we've seen previously, epithelia can be multi- or single-layered and have important functions in protection, secretion, and absorption. Endothelium is often confused with epithelium, and old textbooks may indicate these are the same. However, as we've learned more about these tissues, we're recognizing that there are important differences. Endothelial cells are of mesodermal origin and are always a single thin layer of cells. They do not line surfaces, but instead line the inner walls of blood vessels and lymphatics. We're beginning to appreciate a number of critical functions that endothelial cells perform, some of which are shown here and some of which we'll discuss later in the video on vasculature. Clinically, pathologists do not consider these cells to be epithelial cells, since they do not behave as carcinomas. Finally, we have mesothelium, which is also of mesodermal origin and is a single cell layer. Mesothelium lines internal body cavities. Its function appears to be protective as these cells secrete a fluid that is lubricating. Thus, one sees mesothelium on external surfaces of organs that need to be slippery, since changes in size, shape, and movement are integral to their functions. Organs such as the lungs, heart, and abdominal organs. We'll touch on these differences again as we discuss the heart and the vessels. Let's move to the walls. The cardiac wall consists of three layers. First, the innermost layer facing the chamber of the heart is the endocardium. The middle layer, or the myocardium, is the thickest layer and contains the cardiomyocytes, which act as a functional syncytium. The epicardium forms part of the visceral layer of the pericardium. It is a low-friction surface that is lined by mesothelium and is in contact with the parietal pericardial space. The pericardium itself is composed of two layers, the serous layer, which is composed of the visceral layer, or the epicardium, and the parietal layer. The outer layer of the pericardium is the fibrous pericardium. Only the visceral layer, or the epicardium, is considered part of the heart wall, at least for histologists. Now we'll take a closer look at the characteristics of each layer. First, we have the endocardium, the innermost layer. It is larger in the atria than in the ventricles. Second, we have the myocardium, which is much larger in the ventricles, a distinguishing characteristic between the two heart regions. Finally, we have the epicardium, the outermost layer which faces the body and is lined with mesothelium. Now let's dig a little bit deeper into the specializations of each layer. We'll start with the endocardium. It consists of endothelium that lines the chamber with a subendothelial connective tissue that contains some smooth muscle cells. In the subendocardial space reside the specialized muscle fibers known as Purkinje fibers, which we will discuss further in just a few minutes. Next, we have the myocardium, which again is a functional syncytium of striated cardiac muscle fibers. These fibers make up atrial muscle, ventricular muscle, and specialized excitatory and conductive muscle fibers. It also contains specialized cardiomyocytes that have endocrine function. The epicardium contains coronary vessels and nerves necessary for cardiac function, as well as fat that cushions the heart. This layer is much thicker in the ventricles, another distinguishing characteristic between these two heart regions. Now, we've already discussed some of the characteristics of endothelium and endothelial cells, and we'll go into greater detail about their functions when we discuss vasculature. So what then are Purkinje fibers, and what is their function? To answer these questions, we need to look at the conductive systems of the heart. The heart has an intrinsic rhythmicity that allows our heartbeat to begin and be conducted without external stimuli. The heart has two specialized conductive systems which coordinate contraction and are functionally connected. You'll learn a great deal more about these in anatomy and physiology in this course and also in your second year, but for here we'll just skate over the surface details. The sinoatrial node, or SA node, generates the impulses to cause rhythmic contractions of cardiac muscle. This is an area of modified muscle that is autorhythmic. Its action potential is passed to the atrial muscle cells, which function as a syncytium, and then to the internodal pathway, which conducts this impulse from the SA node to the atrioventricular, or AV node. Here the signal is delayed so that the atria have time to finish contracting before the ventricles start their contraction. Cardiac muscle cells in both of these regions have the ability to both contract and conduct. Histologically, though, there's not much visible to differentiate these from cardiac muscle fibers. Next, the signal moves through the bundle of His and the right and left bundles of fibers, or bundle branches, to the Purkinje fibers. These large, specialized fibers conduct the impulse to the ventricular cardiomyocytes, and these fibers are conducting only. So what do Purkinje fibers look like histologically? Here you can compare and contrast contracting cardiac muscle fibers with Purkinje fibers. The Purkinje fibers are found in the subendocardial space and are larger and paler than cardiomyocytes. They contain fewer myofibrils, lots of glycogen and mitochondria, and no T-tubules. The cells are connected together by desmosomes and gap junctions in what are termed atypical intercalated discs, but they have many voltage-gated sodium channels. In this second micrograph, you can more clearly see differences in size and color of the Purkinje fibers, which is due to fewer myofibrils, a lack of organization of the myofibers, and the increased glycogen stores. The Purkinje fibers are part of the backup pacemaker system of the heart. You've probably heard of a PVC, or premature ventricular contraction. This is a heartbeat initiated in the Purkinje fibers rather than the SA node. This is a response to keep the heart beating, but you can think of this a bit like a passenger having to fly a plane. It's somewhat of a last resort. Now, given what you've learned about Purkinje fibers and the conducting system, you should be able to predict some consequences of abnormal Purkinje fiber function. Another specialization found within the myocardium is the presence of endocrine cardiomyocytes. These cells are found in the atrial wall, and they release a hormone known as atrial natriuretic peptide, or factor. ANP, or ANF, is released in response to high blood pressure. It's sensed by receptors that detect increased stretch, and this hormone acts to lower blood pressure. In this electron micrograph, you can see a myocyte releasing ANP granules. So how exactly does this hormone work? Well, essentially, it stimulates loss of sodium, or natrium, hence its name, from the blood into the urine. As you will recall, water follows sodium, and this will decrease blood pressure and volume. It has several additional functions. It relaxes vascular smooth muscle and acts to block the release of other hormones that function to retain sodium and water. Now, since this is a fairly complicated process, let's break it down a bit and walk through it with a diagram. Here we see the atrial myocardium with myocytes that will secrete ANP granules in response to high blood pressure or volume, shown again here in this electron micrograph. These granules travel through the blood to various target organs, to blood vessels where they act on endothelial cells to increase permeability and on the vascular smooth muscle to cause vasorelaxation. ANP also acts on the kidney duct epithelial cells, which increases sodium excretion. Now, although it's more complicated than even this diagram shows, what you really need to know is that the end result is to lower blood pressure. And we'll talk more about AMP when we get to the kidney. Last but not least, we have the epicardium. The lining of the epicardium, or the mesothelium, secretes a lubricating fluid which allows the heart to move as it contracts and jumps around in the chest cavity. Now, by now, we've pretty well covered the histological attributes of the regions, layers, and some of the specialized functions of cells within the heart. Now let's spend a few minutes talking about changes that can occur within heart muscle.
Let's consider the process of cardiac hypertrophy.
Here you see images of three hearts. The middle one is normal-sized, while the other two show examples of cardiac hypertrophy. Essentially, both of these hearts have increased in size. One has a thicker wall, and one has a larger or dilated chamber. Hypertrophy can be a normal response to increased stress on the heart, whether that is from increased pressure or increased volume. If we look at micrographs of hypertrophied hearts, we see that the image on the right has larger and thicker fibers. These fibers are much more disorganized, and they have larger nuclei that are often called boxcar nuclei due to their shape. It's important to note here that the heart muscle fibers aren't increasing in number, which would be hyperplasia, but they are getting bigger, which is hypertrophy.
One easy way to think about this is going from a normal size Lego brick to a much larger Duplo block. Well, that's it for the heart. If you want to hear more about the cardiovascular system, check out the tutorials on the vasculature and basic cardiac pathology. Thanks for stopping by.